Our program opens with a piece by Benjamin Britten, one of Great Britain's most famous composers of the last century. It's called The Fanfare for St. Edmundsbury, and it was written for the anniversary of that famous cathedral there in the town. Even though it's a 20th century work, Britten intentionally evoked the long history of trumpet calls and of the cathedral he was writing for. So you will hear in this work what sounds like a Gregorian chant from medieval times being performed by the center trumpet, and then his fellows join him in traditional military trumpet calls that are centuries old.
Musical sources spanning a wide period of time, and many are surprised that even going back to the 13th century, we have music that has been composed so that we can try to recreate it in the present. The next piece is an anonymous motet that dates from around the 13th century, and in this motet, what we hear are three very independent voices, each would be assigned its own text, and then they would weave together so that the resulting sound is very pleasant. This was quite a puzzle to be able to take these different texts and put them together musically. So first you will hear instruments playing the musical lines before you actually hear the three voices, each with a different text. Jean-Baptiste Lully was the creator of the French classical style of composition. And no program tracing the history of orchestral music would be complete without one of his works. In the next selection, from his Comédie Lyrique, Les Amants Magnifiques, or The Magnificent Lovers, you'll hear several movements, each based on a different dance form that was popular in the late 17th century at the court of Louis XIV. To make this performance complete, we're fortunate to have a dancer recreating the style, the movements, and most importantly, the fashion of the late 17th century.
Thank you.
Johann Sebastian Bach symbolizes the High Baroque, a great degree of complexity in interweaving different contrapuntal lines, as well as highly ornamented melodies. All of these are evident in his Second Orchestral Suite, which is a composite of movements based on different dance forms. Liz Buck, who's the professor of flute here at our School of Music, is the soloist. And this work gives a wonderful example for her to show the versatility and beauty of the flute.
Thank you.
you're about to hear is by one of the most famous composers of music history, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. This piece was part of a collection for Harmonie, which was an ensemble derived of musicians directly from the work that you heard by Lully earlier, the oboe band made most famous in France. Mozart wrote this in approximately 1782, and it's some of his most endearing music, so much so that it was chosen for the film Amadeus. In this performance this evening, you're going to hear two movements from a seven-movement serenade in B-flat major, nicknamed Gran Partita. You will be hearing the Adagio and the Finale. Thank you.
During the French Revolution, Le Grand Hautbois, which was considered part of the court, was disbanded and a new ensemble was formed, Le Garde Républicain Band. This band and bands like it from France and Italy toured the United States in the early 19th century and greatly influenced American wind and brass players. Subsequently, famous band leaders such as John Philip Sousa modeled their wind bands after the French wind bands of the Revolutionary period. The next two works you will hear were written for these bands, one originally by John Philip Sousa, one of his most famous marches, The Washington Post, and the other, a transcription of an opera scene from Richard Wagner's Lohengrin, Elsa's Procession to the Cathedral. I should just mention that the Sousa March, The Washington Post, was the number one hit tune in 1889.
A major program within our ensemble curriculum is the Lyric Opera Theater, and we present 2 operas and 3 musicals every year here at ASU. To represent this program, our next selection is an excerpt from Richard Strauss's opera, Elektra. The aria, Ich kann nicht sitzen, will be performed by faculty member Carol Fitzpatrick, who has a long career as an operatic singer in Europe and brings that experience to our students here at ASU. The orchestra is incredibly lush and gives a wonderful opportunity to show off the great scope of instrumental studies here.
Nicht heim.
An exciting byproduct of our commitment to this new ensemble training are the partnerships with professional musical institutions throughout Arizona. We are very fortunate to have partners in Phoenix Theater, with the Scottsdale Center for the Arts, and with the Arizona Opera. This creates a marvelous bridge to the profession for our students, and very, very fine opportunities for collaborating on important ventures. Michael Christie is the music director of the Phoenix Symphony, and he's a frequent visitor to our campus. We are delighted to be able to include his artistry in tonight's program.
The first work that Maestro Christie will conduct with our students is one of the most famous works by Igor Stravinsky, who of course shook the world up in the early 20th century with such works as The Firebird and The Rite of Spring. This work, written in 1923 for eight musicians, is the result of two things: Stravinsky's desire to reflect classicism in music, and the fact that after World War I, resources were limited for composers. So the orchestra that you would hear in something like Strauss or Wagner opera is now greatly reduced by many composers, including Stravinsky. This work is a landmark in 20th century composition, Stravinsky's Octet.
Thank you.
John Adams represents the height of American symphonic composition in the year 2010. Adams started life as a clarinetist, a conductor, and a composer who decided in the 1960s to explore his own voice. Subsequently, he latched on to the new minimalist movement that many composers were using, but also wanted to reflect in his music his great love of all of the masterworks. We felt it was appropriate to end this evening's history of orchestral music with a work that reflects back on all of the harmonic movement of the 19th century, on the great rhythmic traditions of the 20th century, and put them all together in a colorful, contemporary American piece, Harmonie Lyrique.